Hello, I'm Jyotika. Welcome to Excelling Psychology. In today's class, we will learn how to design a longitudinal study for paper 2. In this class, I'm going to explain to you not only what steps you need to cover in the study, but I will actually design a sample study and show you. As I'm designing the study, I will show you how to apply the features into the study. And we will also learn about common mistakes that students make while designing and how those can be avoided. On the screen, you have a scenario for a longitudinal study. So this is the typical way in which the question comes on paper 2. The first thing to do when the question comes is to read the question carefully. So I'm just reading out the question. Read it with me and keep in mind exactly what is required in this question. This might seem very obvious, but you need to read the question very carefully. Many students read it in a haste. And then when they're designing the study, once they finish designing, they realize that they have not met the requirements of the question and it's too late to make too many corrections and they get very anxious about it. So first thing is make sure you read the scenario thoroughly. Here they're telling us Mary is planning a longitudinal study to investigate whether people's total REM sleep changes over their lifespan. She wants to know if the total time spent in REM sleep changes from childhood to old age. Design a longitudinal study to help Mary make her investigation. You must not refer to sampling or ethics in your answer. So right away, right here, I would like to point out how students commonly make a mistake at this point. Now here you have been told explicitly not to refer to sampling or ethics. Still, students will begin with either how many participants should be there in the study or what is the technique for recruitment of participants such as volunteer or opportunity sampling. Some of them will also begin with how informed consent is being taken. When they've explicitly asked you not to refer to something, that means you're not going to receive any credit for covering those points. So why should you waste your time and space on the paper over something for which you're not going to be marked? Pay heed to what is said in the question. If they've told you not to do certain things, make sure you don't do them. Now, what should we do after reading the question? After reading the question, we should bring to mind, or if you desire, you can even write down on the paper, say in a margin, somewhere where you have some rough space, with a pencil maybe, all the features that you need to cover. Hopefully, by the time you go into the exam hall, you know what are the features you need to cover for different types of research methods, such as experiments, correlation. So what I'm assuming is by the time you're in the exam hall, you have practiced enough to be able to quickly just jot down which features you need to cover. Why this is important, why making a mental or an actual note of what to be covered is important. Because again, once you start writing the answer and you come a little forward in the answer, then you might realize that there were some features you needed to cover, but you just forgot about them. And then when you place them anywhere, like towards the end of the answer, because suddenly you remembered, they can seem very out of place and the organization of your answer can really dip down because of that. So avoid doing that by just giving maybe a minute at most to just note down which features need to be covered. I'm writing them on the screen now. As you know, there are some general features which need to be covered for all types of studies you're designing. So regardless of you are designing an experimental study, correlation, observation, whatever it is, there are some features which you have to cover. Students often ask me, do we have to only cover all these features? Because there are quite a few of them. Yes, if you look at the mark schemes, clearly it has been specified that if you want to score at level 5, that is in the highest mark band for the 10 marker answer, you must cover all the features with justifications in the sense in details. So writing down all of the features, not forgetting about any of them, is important to scoring well. And design a study, I would personally say, is one question where you can really score well and bring up your grade. You could literally bring up one or two grades by designing the study well. So why lose out marks on this question? Okay, so the general features that you have to cover for any study, including a longitudinal study, is one, the procedure of the study. Two, the type of data being collected. Three, reliability of the plan. and 4, validity of the plan. Then there are some specific features which you need to cover, which are applicable only to longitudinal research method. And you have to cover both specific and general features. I'll just scroll down a little so that you can see. Also, what I'll do is once I complete designing the whole study at the end of the video, I'll just upload a copy of what I'm writing on the screen to my website on PDF. In PDF format, it will be available. So you can just download the copy of the answer that I'm writing and you can keep it with you while watching this video so that you'll be able to understand how we are designing the study better. So when it comes to the specific features of longitudinal study, you must describe what tests or tasks participants are required to do in the study. You must also cover how they will be scored. You must cover frequency or interval of how often or how frequently literally they will be assessed. You must cover recontacting of participants for repeated testing. And you must cover controls or standardization or both. Anyways, many students have a similar definition of controls and standardization. They don't really distinguish between the two. This is something I've addressed in earlier videos. So you just have to cover controls and standardization in that case, because for you it's interchangeable. Okay, at this point I would like to say many students feel that the features are too much to be remembered, and for every study they need to remember different features. Now I would say that remembering the features is the minimum you can do. Of course, you have to prepare for an exam paper, so you will be required to remember some things. But if you're finding it very difficult, a common reason for that is you haven't practiced enough. As such, you don't need to memorize these features. If you have been practicing designing your study, so actually you've been preparing, writing down different studies, as you are, you know, applying these features again and again, they should just get settled in your mind. In the sense, even without having to think, you know, okay, it's a longitudinal study. In a flow, you'll be able to cover all the features because you've practiced. When you haven't practiced, you've just read through some answers and you have just tried to memorize literally from the syllabus what are the features to be covered. That is when you have difficulty in remembering, because you have not put it to practice. So make sure you do enough practice when you go for your, before you go for your paper 2 exam. And in general, in psychology, practice answer writing is the most important thing to score well. All my students who score well are the ones who really practice a lot. So that is a basic requirement in psychology. Don't expect to score high marks just by reading, watching videos, seeing samples. That can take you to a certain point, but till your effort is put into it, you will not be able to score highly. Okay, having said that, now let's begin actually designing the study in Mary's scenario, which has been given. So again, I'm scrolling down so that you can see what I'm writing. Okay, as I said, we shouldn't begin with sampling and ethics because that is specifically not required in the answer. So many students get confused and they'll ask me, then how do we begin if we don't begin with the participants? You can begin with the where and when of the study, because after all, they've asked you to cover the procedure in general features. So one part of the procedure always is where is the study being done and when is it being done. Now, if we look at the scenario, Mary wants to study total REM sleep changes. Just think about it logically and practically. If you were the researcher, keep yourself in Mary's place, where would you be able to do such a study in which you are able to measure how much time people are spending in REM sleep stage? Would you be able to do it in their homes where they are naturally sleeping? It would be very difficult to make provisions for EEG equipment in everybody's homes and, you know, record their REM sleep stage in their homes. So I think definitely most suitable for this type of a study is a controlled setting, just like the one we've seen in Dement and Kleitman. It should be very obvious the scenario has been based off the Dement and Kleitman study. So definitely you can take inspiration from there. By that, I don't mean you start describing the Dement and Kleitman study in the answer, but use the knowledge that you have gained from learning that study and apply it as relevant to Mary's scenario. So I would begin with the location of the study. It gives me a good starting point also. And it covers the general feature which is required, procedure of the study. So I'll be able to do both. So how I would begin is very simply by saying Mary will conduct her study in a laboratory. Also, I will suggest writing the study in future tense because it hasn't been done as of now. And please maintain that future tense throughout the answer. Some students keep switching between past, present and future tense. I know this is not an English class, but it becomes very difficult to read what they are trying to say in the answer because suddenly they switch from future to past tense as if the study has already been done. So very simple things just to make the quality of your answer better. Just try to keep them in mind. Okay, also, whatever we mention in the study, it's good if we can justify. By justify, I just mean, just point out what sense it makes or why it is being done. Not in terms of this is a strength. Like everywhere, students will start saying laboratory is a control setting. It's very valid. That's not what I mean by justification. Just why is she doing it in the laboratory? We can just mention that. And it should be ideally just in one sentence. We can see we have a long list of features to cover. If you are going to write a paragraph on each of the features that we are covering, the answer will never end. So we can say Mary will make provisions for EEG recording of participant sleep stages in this laboratory. So this gives a good starting point to my study, the location of the study. Of course, I can cover when also, like I mentioned, like when is she doing? But given that this is a longitudinal study and in one of the specific features, I am going to specify the interval of testing. That is how frequently she's going to test them. Right now, I'm not finding it very important to say when she will be doing the study because I'm going to cover it anyways later. So now I will move towards some of the specific features of the study. So having begun with the procedure, now I would like to come to the features. When you're writing, you might find it a little awkward to write about a lot of things without referring to the participants at all. So every time, you know, after some time, you'll be tempted to write these many participants are there, males, females, are there something, some comment about the participants. Just refrain from doing that because you're asked not to cover sampling and ethics in your answer. Again, practice will help you to do that. So next, now looking at the specific features, we know we need to cover tests and tasks. So next I need to think, if I was in Mary's place, what task would the participants be required to do so that I can measure their REM sleep pattern? So I should also keep in view that specifically what she wants to measure is the duration of the REM sleep stage. So what should I make them do such that I can know how long they spend in REM sleep? The answer is very obvious. I need them to come to the laboratory, sleep over there so that I can, you know, attach them to the EEG machine and see how long they are spending in the REM stage. Again, taking inspiration from Dement and Kleitman's study. So I just need to specify that next. Participants will be required to come to the laboratory at their usual bedtime and sleep as they regularly do. So here, which feature I'm covering, I would just like to reiterate the tests or task features I'm covering. One more thing is students will say, like, do we need to specify this is the test, this is the task? Like, do we need to point out the specific features explicitly in the answer? No. It's understood. When you're writing the sentence, the examiner reads it and understands, makes a mark that yes, the student has covered the tests and tasks in the study. So you don't need to use the words tests and tasks in your answer as such. Also, some students like to write in bullet points, like the entire answer they like to write as a bulleted list. So test, task, this, scoring this, you know. Please don't write like that. You're expected to show good writing skills. Write in essay format like I'm writing in paragraphs rather than, you know, just making a list. That does not show, that I would say is does not make a very good impression because you're not making a template of an answer or something. You're actually designing a study. So it should look like a proper study, just like your core studies do. Okay, so this is the test and task of the participant. In this study as such, they are not required to give a test. They are required to perform a task. Let's say instead of this, there was some longitudinal study in which the researcher wants to check how theory of mind develops with time or how it declines with time. In that case, the ICE test could have been given to participants at regular intervals, and then in that case they would be giving a test rather than performing a task. So depending on what the study scenario is, according to that, participants will either have to give some tests or perform some task. That's why they have given it that way in the features. Okay, so I can just add one more point to this, that yes, they'll be required to come and sleep, and then what will happen is, because we have to cover the procedure, so we have to explain step by step what is happening. Mary will record their REM sleep duration as observed on the EEG machine as they sleep. Okay, please excuse the typing. I'm having some pain in my wrist. That's why I'm not able to type very smoothly. Okay, also, we can see, I could have elaborated more, like I could have written about the electrodes that need to be attached and all. It's just that it'll make the study very lengthy. So I'm taking a call not to write about how electrodes will be attached to their scalp. You can write those things. If you do, also don't write about EOG recording and all. It's not required in this study. Like I said, some students will just blatantly copy what is then demand and Kleidman. So EOG electrode should be next to the eye so that Mary can see the direction of eye movement. Mary's intention is not to see the direction of eye movement. So don't write things which are irrelevant. Secondly, like I said, just take a judgment of, do you think some details will be unnecessary, like unnecessary elongate the answer such that you're not able to write anything else. Here I feel if I get into how she will attach the electrodes and she'll tie in a ponytail and those things, if I want to write it as standardization or control, I can include that. Otherwise, it's just going to make the answer very long and it might make it impossible to complete the paper. So I'm skipping that. This brings me to one more point. Should we write about as many standardization points, or you know, whatever can be done for standardization in the procedure? Should we write all possible controls in the answer? No, you can just give one or two examples. So right now I don't want to give examples from how the electrodes are being attached. I will use some other point to cover standardization and controls. So it's up to you. When I'm writing an answer, it's just a model answer or a sample answer. Your answer can differ from mine, as long as you're covering the features sensibly in your answer. Okay, so this is the task they have to do, and as they are doing it, Mary will be recording their sleep duration, how much time they are spending in REM sleep in particular. Also, we need to specify how scoring will be done. That's the next specific feature. Here, as far as scoring is concerned, they are not giving a test as such for which they should be scored. But of course, Mary needs to record the duration of REM sleep. So just to make it like operationalized, I would specify that she would record how many minutes they are spending in REM sleep. And because we know from the Dement and Kleidman study that REM sleep occurs repeatedly. In one session of sleeping, there are many stages of REM sleep in various sleep cycles. So that is why I will specify that she will total or sum up all the minutes they have spent in the various REM stages that they have gone through throughout the night. So here in scoring, you can just take as operationalization of the dependent variable. It does not have to be that some test is being given which needs to be scored. Even the task can be scored. So how I will put it is, Mary will total up all the minutes that participants spent in REM sleep stages throughout their sleep session. So this is, I'm indicating how she will do scoring. Okay, besides this, we also need to specify, like if we look at the specific features, what is the frequency or interval of scoring the participants? Again, we need to come back to the question for this. Mary wants to see total duration of sleep stages from childhood to old age. Now, what we consider as childhood and to old age can differ for different students. I would roughly say childhood, I would consider as, say, after infancy, so something like right from when they are about 3 years. Like I said, it's not important. You can have a different age group in your mind. So I think Mary should start investigating right from when the individual is 3 years to when old age, in the sense, for me, say they are around 70, 75 years and more. She can keep on continuing her study for that entire duration. Now, if I suggest something like annually, she should measure their sleep duration. So every year they should come to the laboratory once and she should measure their sleep duration. It was a little impractical and a little unnecessary, because what we've learned in psychology is, when it comes to childhood, there's not a radical difference from year to year that she needs to really measure them every year. I would take something like, say, every 5 years during childhood, and in adulthood, every 10 years she can measure. So that can be the frequency or interval. Or you can even suggest consistently 5 years right from childhood to old age, or consistently 10 years from childhood to old age. Even that is fine. You don't need to vary the interval as such. Just keep in mind, when we talk about interval or frequency, what we mean is how often participants will have to perform the task for being assessed. Because it is a longitudinal study, of course, the same participants will have to keep on coming to the laboratory time to time and keep on doing the task again and again. So the question here is, how often do they have to come? Now, here are a few mistakes which students make, like frequently made mistakes, I would just like to point out quickly. One is, despite it being a longitudinal study, many students, no matter what research method is asked, they will always make it an experiment. I don't know why. So they have, I think, memorized some template or pattern that no matter what is asked, just begin with the IVDV, specify which groups or conditions are being compared, give an experimental design, which is absolutely irrelevant here. And it will really push you down in the mark band. So instead of being on level 5, you'll go down somewhere to level 2 or level 1. Here, if you say that there'll be one group of participants who are children and one group of participants who are older people, and we'll compare. So we'll get both of them to the laboratory and we'll compare how long children are spending in sleep, REM sleep, and how long older adults are spending in REM sleep. You've converted a longitudinal study into an experiment, that also a cross-sectional one, in which in one session only you're going to compare children versus older adults. That is not the requirement at all. Longitudinal study means that you're going to follow up the same participants throughout, from whatever age range to whatever age range is given. So if you give an experiment, you're changing the research method totally, and you're not going to get any credit for that. Like I said, you really drop down on the answer. So first of all, do not convert it to an experiment. Another mistake that students commonly make is, they'll start thinking about how practical is the plan and all. Like I said, it should be logical and practical, preferably. But if you start thinking like someone, I remember discussing this answer in class also, and someone told me that Mary will become very old herself. And what if she expires in the course of the study? Like, who will continue the study? See, no doubt those are practical considerations. But it is understood, if really this study had to be done, then in that case, Mary would be having a team which would follow up the study even after she's no longer there. So such studies happen in psychology, longitudinal studies. You are not to worry about those things. Like, those are extremely practical considerations, which if really you're conducting a study, then you need to consider those. When you're planning the study, your focus has to be on making sure you cover all the features sensibly, not on thinking about really whether the study can be done or not. Having said that, I don't mean you should make a fantasy type of study, which does not have any relevance to the real world. But don't get into too many nitty-gritties. Okay, so coming to frequency or interval, what I would suggest is, like I said, in my opinion, Mary should do 5 years of every 5 years, she should do testing when she's studying them in childhood, and every 10 years when she's studying them in adulthood. Also, one more thing I would suggest here is, I will give the age of participants. It will look like I'm referring to the sample. It is required here because I need to specify the intervals. That's why I'm specifying their age. It's not to refer to sample. Like we saw in the beginning, do not refer to sample or ethics. So that's not what I'm doing here. But what I'm trying to do is just point out the intervals, so it makes sense to say what's the beginning point of assessment and what's the end point. Only for that reason, I'm specifying the age groups. So just see how we write only what is relevant and not what has been said not to be mentioned in the plan. So here I'll say Mary will begin testing the participants when they are 3 years of age, and she will continue to assess them until they are, let's say, 75 years of age. Again, you do not have to worry about things like what if someone does not reach age 75 or they go beyond that. Like I said, don't get into silly details of the study. Second thing is your age ranges can be different from this. As I mentioned earlier, that's fine. As long as whatever ages you're giving do come in the territory of childhood and old age, it's fine. Every 5 years up to age 18, participants will be required to come for assessment to the laboratory. Then onwards, they will be tested every 10 years. So this is, these two sentences are covering the specific feature of frequency and interval, which we had seen earlier. Here again, you might be tempted to say how many participants are there or what is their gender or something. Just avoid that. That is not relevant. And that will make you cover something which you've been told not to cover in the answer. Okay, now another related consideration is recontacting of participants for repeated testing. Like that's the next specific feature. We have to cover both specific and general features. So sometimes we have to go back and forth between these features. We don't have to literally cover them first this, then this, then this. Like they have not given it in chronological order that in this way only you have to cover the whole list. So before going to the recontacting of participants, I would like to cover a general feature which is given above, which is reliability of the plan. I want to talk about that. Why I'm mentioning it here, like why I'm including the feature here, is because I feel this is an appropriate place. Just now I have spoken about how they will have to come to the laboratory for testing. So why not mention what all they will be required to do before coming for the laboratory, which can serve as a control, or once they come to the laboratory, something they'll have to do which would serve as control. Or I could give something about standardization, in the sense that how every time, though they are coming after 5 years or 10 years, Mary will ensure that the procedure will always be the same, which will serve as standardization. So because I'm talking already about them having to come to the laboratory, I feel this is a good place to talk about control and standardization. So now when I'm going to cover the reliability of the plan, I'm going to be covering the specific feature of controls and standardization, as well as the general feature of reliability. Here I would also like to break the paragraph. I feel that's appropriate. It's up to you. You can write a continuous answer also. I just feel that have some empathy for the examiner when you're writing. They have a lot to read about. So if you can make it easy reading for them, that would be beneficial. You don't get less credit as such if you don't break into paragraphs or something. But it can just be helpful for the reader. Okay, so here I'll specify each time participants come to the laboratory for assessment, they will have to refrain from consuming alcohol or coffee. So again, I've taken inspiration from Dement and Kleitman. I'm going to justify this as a control. This will be done to prevent their REM sleep schedule, or you can say sleep pattern, from being disrupted by the consumption of any type of depressant or stimulant. So the justification is also similar to why in Dement and Kleitman they were not to have these type of substances. Okay, I was going to write about reliability, but just now the point I've covered is a control. So I will link this to validity of the plan. So the general feature I will cover here is validity. This increases the validity of the plan. The same point I could have taken as standardization also, because each and every time they are not having alcohol or coffee. So to that extent, the procedure is remaining the same. Like they have to come in the same state every time. So it is a type of standardization as well. So that's why it's reliable. But the way I have justified it as a control, that it is preventing some type of extraneous influence. That's why I have taken it to increase validity. I have to cover both anyways, reliability and validity. So adding one or two more things about standardization, I will also cover the general feature of reliability. So what I'll say is participants will also have to report always just a little before their bedtime. Eat normally as they do every day and sleep in a quiet and dark room of the laboratory, the exact same room with the same arrangement of beds and EEG equipment every time. In this way, the procedure and sleeping conditions will be standardized by Mary such that the reliability of the plan is increased. So here I have specified controls and standardization, which was a specific feature we need to cover. As I said, you could cover any one of them also, only controls or only standardization, but I took it as an opportunity to cover both the reliability and validity of the plan, which are the general features. One specific feature which I haven't covered yet is recontacting of participants for repeated testing. In the order that I'm following or the way that I'm organizing my answer, I think I should cover it in the next paragraph. So like I said, you can move back and forth between the features. That's absolutely acceptable. Whatever you feel improves the organization of your answer and makes it more logical. Okay, so after I have covered some of the general features in this paragraph, I will talk about recontacting of participants. Now, what do we have to cover in recontacting? When we have longitudinal studies, undoubtedly participants have made commitment, though we are not specifying because we have to avoid ethics. We are not talking about how they have given their informed consent to, you know, continue the study for so many years, but we have to remind them as researchers that they need to come back at regular intervals for the testing. So how are we going to do that in practice? How are we reminding them to come to the study? That is what we need to cover in recontacting. Giving some official means of recontacting is always more desirable. So something like emailing participants, it's a formal means of communication. Also, people check their emails regularly. So practically, it makes sense to send emails to people, good way of reminding them in writing. In addition to that, some form of, you know, personal contact, like calling them over the telephone or giving them an online call or something just before the study is about to take place can be very useful. So I'll just give you an example of how you can talk about recontacting. For recontacting the participants, Mary could send them emails annually every year, though they don't come for the study every year, but she can just keep reminding them that they're a part of the study every year. Like that's important to refresh their memory so that they can adjust their commitments accordingly. It's just showing respect for the participants. Emails like annually. Now, whenever you talk about something like you say, okay, she can send emails, it just seems abrupt to just leave it at that. It would be good to just elaborate in one line and say what is going to be written on the emails. So like we see, always justify every point. Why is she giving the emails? You can think of it that way. So in these emails, she will remind them of when they have to come for the study next, and also include details about why their participation is important, and thank them for contributing towards the progress of the study. So what I'm indicating here is every year she's going to be giving them some emails in which she keeps on reminding them what is the importance of the study. I'm not really getting into what purpose she's specifying and all, because that gets into ethics and we don't need to cover that much also. So she's just reminding them from time to time so that it's a soft way of keeping them committed towards the study. And also she's thanking them regularly for their participation. She's expressing their gratitude. That is to show them respect and again motivate them to keep coming for the study. In addition, she will also personally call them over the telephone a week before and a day before their assessment is scheduled to remind them to come for the study and to thank them personally for their participation. So the email she's sending them every year, but in addition to that, just before the study is about to happen, like that's just 1 week before, she'll also personally call them, of course, because that helps her to confirm their attendance and also to like personally have contact with them and keep expressing gratitude and reminding them of their commitment and their importance. As I've mentioned before, I just want to remind there are many ways of going about the same thing. You might have different ideas. You might feel that it's better to contact them over their social media profiles or just call them, no need to email them. Whatever it is, does not have to be exactly what I've written. You don't have to memorize this answer and write. I'm just showing you how you can think about the answer. Now we can just check, like I said, once you write the features, how that is helpful is you make sure you cover all of them and you are able to see or at least mentally scan and, you know, note, have you covered everything or not? When I look at this list, I've covered almost everything. The only thing left is type of data being collected. Okay, many students try to cover A-levels features also in their plan. So in A-levels, you also have to talk about aims, hypothesis, analysis of data, but that all is for next year. This year, when you're planning the study, please stick to the features given for AS level. So they've asked you to cover type of data. They have not asked you to explain how that data will be further analyzed, except for the correlation studies in which the specific feature is to talk about the scattergraph and type of correlation. There we do get into the territory of analysis. Except for that, they haven't really asked you to get into analysis. I would strongly suggest avoiding unnecessary features which just take up too much of your time and they don't leave much time for you to think about other answers. So just stick to how much is given. They want you to cover all the features, not any extra features which are beyond all the features. Okay, so coming to type of data, I have mentioned somewhere in the plan, I'll just highlight it, that Mary is going to be totaling up the minutes that they are spending. It's understood it is quantitative data, but we need to specify. We need to specify that quantitative data is being collected. So when they say type of data, they just want you to literally state what type of data it is and why you're saying that it is that type of data. Again, not to mention the strength. So don't get into its objective and it's going to be valid and all. That is something you have follow-up questions for. In the following questions, they ask you about give one practical strength, give one practical weakness. You can cover it there. When I say justification in 10 marks answer, just why you are saying it's that type of data is what you need to mention. So finally, at the end of the study, I will write, I'll take a new paragraph. Mary is collecting quantitative data by calculating the minutes of sleep spent in REM sleep by the participants. Now, how should we finish off the answer? Like, what should be the last statement which we should give? What we can do is, as a good conclusion, we can refer back to the question and just check again what is the purpose of Mary's study to begin with. And then we can conclude something about that. So let's come back to the question. Mary wants to know if total time spent in REM sleep changes from childhood to old age. This is the intention. So now how will she come to a decision of does this really happen or not? What she's wanting to check. She is at the last point, what we have said is, she is calculating how much time has been spent in REM sleep. So all she needs to see is this total time, is it increasing with age or not? So we can conclude by saying that this is what she's going to analyze. Like I said, we don't get into the analysis as such. So don't get into the statistics of it, like she'll be calculating means or she will be drawing bar graphs or something. Don't get into that. Just mention as a conclusion point that she will just see the trend over time. Is the total duration increasing with age or not? Many students, when I tell them that this is how you can conclude, they come up with the question that, but we can't conclude the study because it actually hasn't been done. So the student will tell me, how can I make a statement that in old age, they are sleeping more in REM compared to childhood? That is not what I'm asking you to do in the conclusion. I'm not telling you to give a definitive answer as if the study has been done, that this is what Mary has found. Of course, we can't say that. Actually, there's no study which has been done. So we can't give a definitive conclusion. But we can say what she will do to come to a conclusion for her study. That is what we need to write. So what we can write is, she will note the trend of time spent in REM sleep with age, whether the total duration in terms of minutes spent in the stage increase or decrease with age, to come to a conclusion for her investigation. Okay, with this I have covered all the features required for the 10 mark study, all the general features as well as all the specific features, because we need to cover all of them. Now very quickly I will just tell you how this will be marked on the mark scheme. I'm not going to get into much details of this, I don't have that much time right now. But just a gist I'll give you of how this answer will be looked at in terms of the mark scheme. Okay, for a level 5 answer, by level 5 answer we mean for an answer to score between 9 and 10 marks, let's see what is required. There is a table, I have covered this in one of the videos before, so you can just go to my channel, I don't remember which video it is, on designing a study for paper 2, which video you can see. In that I have covered actually in detail what the mark scheme requirements are. So there's a table through which your 10 marker answer is scored. You have to make sure that you are on the top band of that table. Please give me a minute, I'll just show it to you on the screen. Okay, at the top of this document, I'm just adding from the mark scheme from the paper what is the requirement for scoring in level 5, that is to get 9 or 10 marks in the paper. So here what you can see is the study has to have all the required features. Now, what they mean by all the required features is it should have specific as well as general features. So as I took you through the plan, I showed you that all the specific and general features have been covered. I'm sorry. Another requirement is they have to be covered with detail. As I took you through the plan, I also showed you how we are detailing. Like for one example, when I mentioned controls, I did not say Mary will include controls and that's why validity of the plan increases. I specified what controls she's including. The example I gave is alcohol or coffee will not be allowed to be consumed. So that's how I've given detail of the feature of validity and control. In the same way, when I mentioned quantitative data, I mentioned that because she's calculating the minutes they have spent, that is why it is quantitative data. Or for example, when I spoke about recontacting the participants, I mentioned how she'll be doing it through emails and through personal telephone calls. So that is how I have added detail. It's not that I just memorize the features. Okay, these are the general, these are the specific features. Now let me write. There will be reliability, there will be validity, there will be controls. That's not how we go about it. We give details. So that's how we come to the level 5 mark band. Appropriate terminology has to be used. I have used appropriate terminology, as you've seen, where it's about recontacting. Like I said, you don't have to mention the word given in the feature. But if you're talking about recontacting and you need to specify, then make sure you're using the word recontacting there. Instead of just saying she'll get in touch with participants or she will greet the participants or something, you should use appropriate terminology such as recontacting. Also, when I have specified about controls, there I have mentioned, like say, alcohol or coffee. That is appropriate terminology in the sense that I have not only made it specific, I have used terms which are found in the course studies or which are psychological in nature. Rather than just saying she'll tell them not to drink, you know, something vague, we have to use good terminology, psychological terms which we've learned in course studies and which show sophistication in the answer basically. Also, one more requirement given is you have to apply the knowledge of methodology in this investigation. Whatever we have written is relevant to Mary's investigation. Her investigation is about REM sleep duration. It's covering childhood to old age. All of what we have written is in view of that. We haven't deviated from the topic at all. This investigation is about REM and ages, and that is what we have covered in the answer. We haven't strayed and started covering Dement and Kleitman instead, which was about comparison of REM and NREM. We have not even mentioned NREM. So this is about being focused and relevant. And of course, applying, like we saw before, not just mentioning this will be there, that will be there. How it will be there in this particular study, that is what we have mentioned. One feature which you can see here is it must be continuous. This is not relevant for our study. Actually, I have picked up this screenshot from the mark scheme, which is there for May, June 24. That was a correlational study. That is why this point has been mentioned, because in correlation, you know, the two co-variables which you have both have to be measured on a continuous scale. Right now, we are talking about a longitudinal study. So this is not what is required. Okay. You can also check out, I will leave it for you, like self-study. What are the requirements for the other levels? 4, 3, 2, 1, like how you can drop down to those levels. You should be aware of that also. So that you can check on your own in any mark scheme, even the specimen mark scheme, which is available to you. You can just check how your answers can drop down. So you will see things like if you've not covered all the features, or if you have not used appropriate terminology, or if you've not been relevant to the question, that is when your answer drops down. As I said, I don't have that much time today to cover in that much detail, but I just want you to see this is what you're aiming for level 5, and these are the requirements for level 5. I know that there are also two follow-up questions after the 10 marker, one to do with practical strength, one to do with practical weakness. Again, I don't have time for that today, but I have made a suggestion. If you watch the video fully, what you can include in that, I have suggested. If you would like me to cover those answers as well, I can make a follow-up video to this one. You can just suggest in the comments box below that you want that video as well. Any other questions or queries you have about this video, please leave it in the comments box below, because I will answer only there. I do share my personal contact as well, but that is only if you want to schedule classes or if you want tuition from me. So please don't ask me anything about YouTube channel videos on personal contact. I will not be answering them. As you have seen in this video, I have helped you to design a study. But I mentioned something at the beginning very quickly. I just want to remind you of that. You need to practice to be able to write your study in paper 2. No doubt my videos of other creators who are also suggesting how to design your studies are very helpful. But they will not secure your high grade in the exam. When you will secure your high grade in the exam is when you practice your answers, when your mistakes are pointed out, and when you are told how to improve and correct your answers. It's good if you realize it now. Many students get very low grades in the paper, then they realize and then they come to me for classes. I have number of students who come to me after getting C, D, E grade, or even after getting ungraded, and they tell me they were very confident about getting A and A stars, and they were shocked when they got a C or D or E grade, and then they come to me because they want to reappear for the exam. Be wise, take your classes or tuition right now only, before you get a very poor grade and then you realize that you need to take tuition. Because you need personalized feedback, which unfortunately you're not getting in many schools. So you need personalized feedback. You need to know what your mistakes are. You need to know how to improve on your mistakes. By looking at one sample answer, you will not know what your personalized feedback needs to be. So take your tuitions right now before you have to get into the cycle of reappearing for the exams, because when you have to reappear for the exam, not only you have to give your 11th grade exam, again, you're simultaneously preparing for 12th grade as well. And it becomes very difficult to prepare for both together. So that's my suggestion to you. As I said, any feedback you have on this video, you can leave in the comments box. I will meet you soon with another video. If I get comments from your side, it will be a follow-up to this one. Otherwise, we will cover some other topic for the paper. You can also make suggestions of what video you would like me to bring up next. Okay, thank you for watching this video, and until next time. Bye.